Invitations allow us to kind of catch a break from the ordinary life that we have. Now, when I say that, you go, what do you mean catch a break? Well, here's what I mean by that. If we didn't have an invitation to do something different, we would wake up every morning and we would do our same routines. We're creatures of habit, right? We wake up, if you're married, maybe you bring coffee to your spouse every morning. Maybe you yell at your spouse every morning. I don't know what it's like between y'all, right? So I don't know what happens in the morning for you, but everybody has their morning routine. They wake up, they take the dog out, they sit down, they eat breakfast, they have their coffee, they read their paper, they look on the internet, they watch TV, the news, whatever the case may be. Then they go out through the rest of the course of their day, and they continue to take care of the kids or get them off to school or wherever they need to be. Or if you're retired, you're not messing with that anymore, but you've got other stuff. You've got lunch plans you got to kind of get ready for. So you go through your morning routine and your mid-morning routine and then your lunch routine and your mid-afternoon routine and your dinner routine. And eventually you go back to bed, probably about the same time that you went to bed the night before. And your routine kind of continues over and over again unless somebody gives you an invitation to do something a little bit different. Somebody gives you an invitation to go to coffee, or somebody gives you an invitation to go look at a Facebook page that you have not looked at before. Somebody gives you an invitation just to kind of catch a break, and you get excited about them. Because the truth of the matter is, we get tired from the normal wear and tear that lies in our life. And here's what I mean by that. We have so much going on. There are so many things in our life that are going on that we're worried about constantly, that we're dealing with constantly. Some of them, I'm going to talk about some of them this morning, and you may walk out of here going, man, I didn't know I had so many worries until I came to church this morning. But I'm going to talk about some of them here this morning because I want you to understand there's a lot going on in our lives. We're tired people. We're tired from things like raising a family. I mean, if you're in here this morning and you've got kids, you understand that there was a point in time where you and your wife got married and you found out you were going to be, you know, going to have a child, and you thought all of a sudden excited, but then you thought, oh my word, how are we going to be able to afford a child? How are we going to be able to raise this? How are we going to discipline this child? How are we going to raise this child spiritually? What about when we have to potty train this child? Who's doing that? I'm not doing that. You must be doing that. We try to get these things. These are constant fears and worries. When they go to elementary school, will they be bullied or will they be the bully? Will they be smart? Will they be cute kids? Will they be funny kids? Will they be kids you want to kick across the room? What kind of kids are these going to be? Am I going to raise these kids well? How am I going to take care of these kids? How am I going to love these kids and encourage these kids in the way that they need to be encouraged? How am I going to protect these kids? These are all worries that as parents, you've either all gone through or will go through at some point in time. How am I going to get these kids educated? How am I going to make sure they know Jesus? These are all things that we deal with as parents. And it's hard. And it stays with us constantly, and it's constantly going. But you think, you know what? On top of that, I've got to build a career. Which means I need to, at some point, have figured out in college what I want to do with my life. If I didn't go to college, then I need to figure out in high school, what do I want to do with my life? And then if I get a job, how long do I stay at this job? Is it a good job for me? And should I take another job within 6 months? Or should I wait 2 years to make it look better on a resume? Or should I stay at this job forever? And is this job going to help me to become everything that I think I need to be in order to be able to support the family that I now have? What do I do in this career? How do I build this career? How do I get better at this career so that people want me around, so that they find me valuable enough to keep around? How do I become an expert in my field? And what if I start becoming an expert in my field and I find out I really like it? Now what do I do? Because I've spent all this time putting all my energy and effort into this, and I got my degree in this, and now I want to go do something else, but I don't really know what I want to do. But I got a family I've got to raise. So what does that look like now? So building a career, raising a family, getting an education, students, so you're in here. I mean, you're walking through it right now, trying to figure out, hey, who do I hang around in school that won't get me in trouble? What do I need to learn? Do I really need to know math because I really don't like math? Do I really need to know science because I don't like science? What do I want to do with my life? And where will this take me into college? Or do I need to go to college? Like, there's a lot going on in your lives. Maybe it's developing friendships. Some of you in here are what we call extroverts, and you like to have as many friends as you can possibly like get. And so you gather all those people up, you find them on Facebook, on Twitter accounts, or whatever the case may be. You're the one that designs parties at your home all the time or at the club, and you're the one that's constantly kind of getting everybody together. But here's the thing. At the end of the day, you can gather as many people as you want to, but in order to get to really know them, you're going to have to get knee-to-knee with them every once in a while, and you're going to have to develop some friendships. You're going to have to put more time and effort into just, hey, I'm going to throw in a big party and everybody come at once to, I really want to develop a relationship with you. Let's see what that looks like. And let's begin to talk and become friends and pray with one another and talk with one another and find out what's going on in your life. You find out what's going on in my life and we become friends. That takes a lot more effort. And then there's the people in this room that have all the friends they need. They don't want any more. They're like, I'm good. I've got a spouse. Leave me alone. And so you're good. Like we call you introverts and you're okay. It's no big deal. But even that can be burdensome on you because even the introverts that I've had the opportunity to visit with and to talk with in my life and to be friends with in my life, even still at some time, they just want to feel wanted. They want to know that people want them around, even though they don't want them around. They want to know that people want them around. And it's a weird deal, and we have these pressures and these burdens that come all over us and doing all of those things. We have the pressure and the stress of dealing with loss in our life, either loss financially, like kind of the economic downturn that we're going through right now can kind of set people on their heels and get them thinking and worried about all the things that are going on. How am I going to protect my finances? How am I going to protect my portfolio? How am I going to protect my family? What do we need to cut back on? Maybe a loss in of a loved one, or loss of health. And now you've got to find a doctor and find somebody that can walk you through this and give you the right medications and the right therapy in order for you to be able to kind of come back and to beat this thing, whatever it might be. See, we've got these things that we're constantly going over in our lives that are constantly putting pressure, and we don't even realize because we've been trained culturally to take everything. Man, I can carry this on my shoulders. I can do this. I'm smart. I'm educated. I'm well-groomed. I can handle this thing. And so we take stress after stress after stress. But then something else comes along. Somebody complains about you at work. Somebody criticizes you at work. Somebody can complain about you because you're working too hard. You're making me look bad because you're doing all the work, and now I've got to work harder because you're working harder. Can you calm down a little bit, right? Or they criticize you at work because maybe you're not doing enough. Maybe it's because you don't know exactly what you're doing and you're trying to learn, but nobody will teach you, and so you're stressed out about that as well. Maybe at home you're catching criticism and complaints because the kids don't like what you're cooking or because you're disciplined in a way that they don't agree with. You're going to catch complaints and criticism where you'll catch it at church. I dare one of you to go touch the thermometer in this room right now. I promise you, you will get criticized. There will be complaints, and I'll have to deal with it on Monday morning. It's going to come at you from wherever and whenever it can. It's just constantly going to happen that way. And so these things build up. When we're doing this stuff, we have to figure out a way to adapt to things going on in our culture. We have to adapt to things culturally and morally and musically. Like, guys, I'm a product of my dad's country music. I love the Statler Brothers. I love Charlie Pride. I love all those guys, Waylon Jennings and all those guys. But I don't care much for today's country music. How do I deal with that? Well, it doesn't really matter how I deal with it, honestly. But the fact is you have to make adjustments and adapt to things all the time in your life. And things are going to change in your life. And that's when those things change in a moment that it turns from being just stressed and tired to becoming something that makes us weary and something that's a burden for us. When weariness becomes a burden, when it is unexpectedly severe or longer than we anticipated for it to be. When I was coaching, I was a defensive coach, and at the last school I coached at, we had a call on our sidelines called sudden change. And what sudden change meant was that the defense had done their job. They'd come to the sidelines, and we're sitting there meeting and trying to get ourselves kind of prepared for the next series that we're going to have to go out. And all of a sudden, the offense goes out there on the very first play, and they fumble the ball or throw an interception. And all of a sudden, everybody starts screaming, sudden change, sudden change, sudden change. Now, what we have to do in that case is we can't overreact, right? We got to go out there. We got to do what we're supposed to do, do what we've been coached to do, and get the ball back. That's the job, right? It's a sudden change in our life. When sudden changes take place in our lives, they can be burdensome. They can rock our world because one moment you wake up and everything's fine, and then with the next breath, everything had changed. Everything has changed. Your world will never be the same as it was, and all of a sudden, you're having to deal with that sudden change in your life. I was on a mission trip in Arecibo, Puerto Rico, back about 2010 or 11. I can't remember. If you check me, it could be something different, but it doesn't matter. Arecibo, First Baptist Church, Arecibo, Puerto Rico. We were down there with the pastor, and we got down there, and the first night, I looked at him, and said, all right, pastor, what are our plans for tomorrow? And he says, well, I don't know yet, but I'll let you know in the morning. I said, okay, great, because I wasn't really aware of how things worked. But in this community, it was where all the people from San Juan, because San Juan is a tourist area, and San Juan didn't want any of its degenerates in San Juan because all the tourists came to San Juan. And so they shipped them off to Arecibo. And so Arecibo was the poorest of the poor. It was people who had been let out of prison and told not to come back to San Juan. It was people who were walking the streets, homeless, drug-infested area. It was awful. And we're in this area, and the area that we're in has about four buildings that are called the ghetto area. And there's a church just down the street from those four ghetto areas. And we were ministering as well as we could to those particular buildings. And so I asked him that night, I said, what are we doing the next day? He said, I don't know. I'll let you know in the morning. I said, okay. So we got up. We did all the stuff we were going to do throughout that day. I asked him the next evening. I said, all right, what are we doing in the morning? He goes, I don't know. I said, can I ask you a question? He said, sure. I said, do you not know because you don't plan, or do you not know because something else is going on? He goes, well, here's the deal, JJ. He said, understand there's two people that run this community. It's me as the pastor of this church and the influence that I have in this direct area, and it's the drug kingpin. He said, what I can do depends a lot upon what that drug kingpin and I will allow me to do. He wants me to come into his community, but he holds me back in certain areas. He doesn't want me to do anything that's going to mess up his business. So during the middle of the night, on that second night we were there, everything changed. And the reason everything changed is because that drug lord got shot and killed in the middle of the night. And so there was a window of about 2 to 3 days before the next guy took his place, where the church had full advantage and full access to the ghettos. And so we went out in cars, and we put speakers on top of the cars, and we parked in the middle of the street. And this pastor and his worship team began to lead worship in the middle of the street. And people were coming out on their balconies from these ghettos and opening their windows, and they're listening to the worship, and they're listening to the message that the pastor gave. And at the end of it, he does an invitation for people to accept Christ. And people are inviting us to come up into their apartments and to pray with them and to talk with them and to kind of give them more information about what we'd been talking about. And we saw lots and lots of people get saved. It was one of the coolest experiences that I've ever had. Here's why it happened. Because somebody got shot and killed. There was a sudden change that changed everything. That happens in our lives. We are going by our lives, we're doing our routines, we're doing all of our stuff, and then all of a sudden, some sudden change takes place in our life, and not only does it take place, but now it's no longer a stress, but it's a burden. It's something that's weighing us down. It's something that consumes our thoughts. Have you ever had anything that has consumed your thoughts so much that it's the only thing that you could think about? It's the only thing that you could imagine. It's the only thing that you could kind of work through throughout every course of the normal part of your day. You were just thinking about how does that fit into this? How does that fit into this? And so what happens is, as you allow those things to drive your thoughts, it then eventually begins to drive your emotions. Ever had a conversation with somebody that snapped at you unexpectedly? And you thought to myself, where did that come from? Like, I didn't say anything or do anything to deserve that. But out of nowhere, somebody snaps at you and says something to you, and you thought, that was just wrong. Problem is, they're probably going through something that you have no idea what they're going through. That's become a burden to them, that's driven their thoughts so much that it's driving their emotions. And they said, they heard something from you, and they reacted not because of what you did, but because of what their emotions are driving them to do. And those same emotions cause us to make poor choices. They cause us to make poor choices because when we're burdened, we're apt to give in to temptation. How many times have you done something you would never have normally done, but you just weren't in your right frame of mind? Something was going on in your life, something just wasn't quite right, and you made a choice, you made a decision to do something that you knew wasn't right, but you did it anyway. And then what happens is that you begin to deal with that because you're so upset about it, and you're like, man, I can't believe I messed that up. I made a poor choice. I made a wrong choice. And it just seems like every time I make a choice, every time I make a decision, it's the wrong decision. And so now I'm fearful. I'm fearful to move forward. I'm fearful to do anything else because every time I seem to do something, it's the wrong something. And so I don't want to continue to go forward and do something else wrong. And we get stuck in this cycle that causes us to stay in a state of mental and physical and spiritual exhaustion that leads us to telling ourselves lies. God doesn't love me. God can't possibly love me in the condition that I'm in. God can't possibly care for me in the way that I need to be cared for. And sometimes it leads to us taking vengeance on other people, taking it out on people that don't deserve for us to take anything out on because they didn't do anything. But the constant state of what we're going through, they don't know. And it leads to despair and it leads to distress. And so in Matthew chapter 11, when Jesus says, "All you who are weary and burdened," that's the problem. Those are the people he's talking to. You say, "Jamie, I didn't know I had any problems until you just got through with this part." I understand that. But we all have these moments where we're walking through this stuff and we're carrying this stuff. And the problem is we don't ever let it go. We carry it because we think we're the only ones that are capable of carrying it. We think we're the only ones who can solve our problems. And so we carry these loads and we continue to carry these loads until they finally drag us down and beat us down to the point where we feel like we are completely exhausted and we can't go anymore. And God says, look, through Jesus, he says, "Come to me. Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." That's the problem. Then he gives the invitation. That's the invitation to those that are worried and burdened like that. Let me paint you a picture. And I think most everybody can visualize this picture because I'm going to bet there's not anybody in this room that hasn't gone through this exact thing I'm about to talk about. Remember back to when you were a kid, 3, 4, 5, 6 years old. Some of you have to think back a little further. I'll give you some time. Okay. Think back to when you were a kid, 3, 4, 5, 6 years old, and you're outside playing, you're riding your bike, you're doing whatever it is that you're doing, and all of a sudden, tragedy strikes. You wreck your bike, you fall down, and you skin your knee. Doesn't hurt at first, but you look down, and you see the skin that's kind of torn up a little bit. You see the blood beginning to come to the surface of the skin, and all of a sudden, it starts to drip down your leg. And what do you do as a child? What everybody does as a child, you see it, it freaks you out, and all of a sudden you begin to cry, right? And all of a sudden, your blood's coming down your leg, you're crying because your world has ended because there is a flesh wound that you do not know what to do with, right? And you're bawling, and it hurts, and it stings, and your world has come to an end. Up until the moment that you look up and you see your mom or your dad standing there, and what do? You go screaming towards your mom or your dad because what you know is they can make it better. Now, you don't know why, but you know they can make it better. So if you're lucky enough that your dad is the one that comes and gets you, he picks you up and he puts you on his knee and he tells you it's going to be all right, quit your crying, and he takes some dirt and he rubs it on the sore because that's what dads did, right? You just rub a little dirt on it, son, you'll be fine. You keep on going. You'll be good. And you start to kind of feel better because, okay, maybe dirt does work. I don't guess. Don't run to grandma, though, because grandma's got that stuff that stings when she puts it on there. You don't want to do that. Stay away from that stuff. But if you go to mom, mom's got her arms wide open. She picks you up and she holds you. She doesn't even touch the sore because she knows it hurts. Right? She doesn't want to cause any undue pain or pressure on you. So she just begins to hold you and rock you, and she lets you know that everything's going to be okay. And at some point, eventually in the whole process, you were crying and tears were streaming down your face. And now all of a sudden, because they've rubbed dirt on it or they held you, all of a sudden now you find yourself laughing through the tears. Y'all remember that? Because I'm sure it's probably happened to just about everybody in this room. The same principle applies with Jesus right here. We're going through these burdens. We're going through these things that have got us to the point of tears. Our life is devastated and it seems like it's over. And we don't know what to do with it anymore. And we look up and we see Jesus with open arms and we go running. Why? Because we know he can take care of them. We may not be able to articulate exactly why, but we know he can take care of them. That's the invitation that he gives to us. He gives us that invitation and we know we can trust him just like we trusted our parents. If we could have articulated it when we were 3, 4, 5, or 6 years old, we would have said, we can trust our parents because we know our parents love us. We didn't know that then. What we knew is because of our prior experience with them, we knew that every time something like this had happened, they always took care of us. They always loved on us. They always held us. They always made everything better, right? And Jesus does the same thing. as we have walked with him, as we're getting to know his character and understand who he is, and we can look back on our lives and we can see the times that we struggled in life and went through some very difficult times in our life, and we can see where Jesus was at work. The beautiful part of that is that when we look back at those things, it gives us trust for the things that we're going to have to go toward him for in the future. When he's got his arms open, we know we can run to him because he has been so faithfully loving to us in the past. And so we run to him, and we can run to him for several reasons. One, because he showed us, but two, because Scripture shows us. I want y'all to see this in Daniel 9:9. Here's what it says. It says, "The Lord our God is merciful and forgiving, even when we have rebelled against him, even when we've made poor decisions. God looks at us, and he is merciful and forgiving." In Romans 5:8, it says, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, is that when while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Guys, we have a God who is going to comfort us and help us when we have fallen and when we are hurting, because that's the kind of God he is. We have a God who comforts us in the midst of our tears. In Deuteronomy 31:8, it says, "The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged." All these things that you're dealing with right now, that you will deal with or you have dealt with, God's gone before you in all of them. He knows the way it's going to work out. We still have to walk the walk, and we have to go through all of this stuff, but it makes me feel a whole lot more confident knowing that Jesus is right there with me. It makes me a whole lot more confident knowing that he's already gone before me. He's straightened out the path. He's not doing it so that I don't have to walk him. He's doing it so it'll make it easier. But it's still hard. There's no guarantee of comfort. In John 16:22, Jesus tells his disciples, "Now is your time of grief, but I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy." Can you imagine the disciples understanding that he was about to be crucified? And Jesus looks at them like, "Grieve for right now. Go through it. You need to go through it. And I understand that. But understand this, you will see me again. And nobody will be able to take away your joy based upon what you've seen. Your eternity will be secure." As we go through the stuff in our life, Jesus says, "Grieve for it. Absolutely grieve for it. But understand, you will have a joy that nobody can take away, and you will go through this, and you will win." Every once in a while, one of the most spiritual things that we can do as Christians is take a nap. Take a nap. But you know what? I don't know about you, but there have been moments in my life where I have stressed out about something so much that I could lay awake all night long and never catch a wink of sleep because my heart and my mind are not settled. I don't have the answers that I want. And all night long, I'm just grieving and I'm thinking of the worst case scenarios. And Jesus said, "No, take a nap. Let me deal with all that stuff." Shows you in the scripture, Proverbs 3:24 says, "When you lie down, you will not be afraid. When you lie down, your sleep will be sweet." That's the invitation that he gives us. And in Matthew chapter 9, if you don't believe that he practiced what he preached, in the middle of a boat, in the middle of a storm, chaos all around him, Jesus was asleep. Guys, we have to trust Jesus so much so that in the midst of everything that's burdening us, that we can lay down and go to sleep and know that he's got everything completely under control. That's the invitation that he gives to us. The problem is that we're burdened. We live in a world that's going to burden us, and we carry these stresses every day. And the invitation is, come to me, all of you who are going through this stuff, and I will give you rest. He goes, "Come to me, and I'll take you in my arms. Come to me, and I'll make the pain stop. Come to me, and I will give you rest." And then here's the result, and this is the sweetest part. The result of this whole deal is that we will never walk alone again. When we come into that relationship with him, when we trust him in that way and understand his character in that way, we will never have to walk alone again. There are times in our life with the people that we're the closest with. We love the most. We trust the most. We pour out our heart to them. And they don't do exactly what we needed them to do with it. They fail us. They say, "Well, I hope you get better. Or maybe they didn't pray for us, but they didn't come alongside of us and walk with us the way that we were kind of hoping they were going to come alongside of us and walk with them. They didn't know. We will fail one another. But Jesus will never fail us. And he says that in verses 29 through 30 when he says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Here's what he's saying. None of you know what a yoke is. A yoke was a wooden brace that would take two oxen back in that day and put them together so that they could work together. They were more powerful as one unit rather than two separate units, right? And so they were able to plow fields easier. They were able to move things easier. They were able to get more work done and move some stuff that the average person wasn't going to be able to move. The idea was that the two were better together. And Jesus is saying, hey, the yoke that I have that you can join up with me in, it's light. It's not burdensome. You don't have to worry about it. You can rely on my power. You and I can walk this thing together. You and I don't have to be alone. We can do this together. And I want you to know that there's a partnership from this point forward that's going to allow you to be able to accomplish what you need to accomplish. It might not be easy, but we will accomplish it in the end. Because what Jesus is saying in this invitation is that through the cross, I have carried every single one of your burdens. Watch this. To their final end. To their ultimate end. I've taken every burden that you have, every problem that you have, every sin that you have. I have taken it into the cross. And through the cross, I have taken it to its ultimate end. You don't need to worry about it anymore. There are going to be consequences because of those things in your life, but you don't have to worry about it anymore. Because it may last for 2 weeks, it may last for 2 months, or it may last until you go and meet Jesus. I don't know. There's no promise of resolution, but there is the promise of Jesus walking with you as you walk through it. And I think there's a lot of times that we as people don't understand that we don't have to do everything on our own. We need Jesus. Jesus wants us to lean in on his power. We need to lean in on his power. And we need to trust him and run to him and let him hold us and take care of us, rub some dirt on it so that we can continue to do the things he's called us to do. Because Jesus is better. I want you to watch this video that we found. I think it does a great job of kind of proving this point, and then we're going to come back and finish this up.
Three words, one sentence, and I hope you never forget it. I hope you always remember these 13 letters, these three words, and this one complete sentence. Jesus is better. He's better than any passing dream you might be chasing after. He's better than any worldly ambition that may have captured your devotion. He's better than anything that could distract you from doing what you were created to do. He's better than money, cars, clothes, entertainment, achievement, and popularity. He's better than anything this world can offer you. Jesus is better. He's better than any person that has ever walked this earth. He's wiser than Gandhi and smarter than Einstein. He's more eloquent than Shakespeare and more creative than Mozart. He's more powerful than Napoleon and more compassionate than Mother Teresa. There's never been anyone like him, nor will there ever be. Not even close. Jesus is better. The Bible says he's better than Adam, better than Abraham, better than Moses, David, and Mary. He's better than the angels, better than the demons, better than any prophet, priest, or saint. From beginning to end, this book has one beautiful story and one unified theme. The Bible is clear. Jesus is better. But there will be times when it's hard to believe. Times when it doesn't feel like Jesus is better. The world will reject you, your flesh will fight you, and the devil will lie to you. Storms will come. You're gonna face disappointment, deception, betrayal, and rejection. You're gonna feel tired, empty, brokenhearted, scared, and alone. But don't forget in the darkness what you learned in the light. Jesus is better. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the Prince of Peace and the Light of the World. He's the friend of sinners and the enemy of Satan. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He is the way and the truth and the life. Jesus is better. And if you really, truly believe it, it's going to cost you. You're going to help the poor, defend the powerless, swallow your pride, and love your enemies. You're going to study the scriptures when you'd rather scroll your phone. You're going to pray when you'd rather sleep. You're going to serve when you'd rather be served. And you're going to speak up when you'd rather be silent. But when it's all said and done, you won't regret it. You'll say, it was worth it. Jesus is better. I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ. In other words, Jesus is better. 13 letters. 3 words. 1 sentence. And no question about it. Jesus is better.
So here's the invitation. The invitation first is to those who have no relationship with Jesus whatsoever. That's always the main invitation. If you don't know Christ, if you don't know what it's like to have a piece of eternity with him, I'm going to be right down here at the front of this when Matt's singing. And if you need to settle that, don't go anywhere else. Don't do anything else until you've got that settled. That's the most important decision you'll ever make in your life. But here's the other part of this. And I want to challenge you every Sunday that I come in here, and it's this. My challenge is to you that you would be an invitation to somebody this week. Not to church. I mean, I don't mind you inviting them to church, but that's not what I mean. Be an invitation to somebody that needs to just go have a cup of coffee, that needs to break the routine of their day, because the routine of their day has got them in such a state they can't even function. And they don't know, they're not letting anybody know about it. They're just dealing with life. You are the only one, possibly, that can have a major, profound effect on their eternity and on their life right now simply by asking them to go have a cup of coffee. Asking them what's going on in their life, being willing to pray with them, and being willing to sit with them, being willing to cry with them, and being willing to listen. Be an invitation to somebody. Don't just go home this week and do your normal routine with your stuff. There's somebody in your life. We looked at this a few weeks ago. Jesus places relationships in our life, not just so that we can say, hey, look at all the relationships we're in. He places relationships in our life because he knows he has especially equipped you to be a blessing to them. So who will you invite to anything? Maybe a conversation on FaceTime, a cup of coffee, or to church. Who will you invite so that you can be a blessing to them in their lives this week? Satan will tell you, don't do it now. Whether it's come down forward and give your life to Christ or to make a phone call when you leave church this morning. Don't do it right now. Because he knows that effective Christians are going to do exactly what we need to do right now. But delayed obedience is disobedience, right? If God's putting somebody on your heart, if he's telling you to do something, don't wait. Step out. Have the courage to do exactly right now what needs to be done. Amen? Father, we love you. And we thank you for the invitation that you've given to us through Jesus. That we can take our burdens and our weariness and lay them down on him. And he'll take them. And he'll give us rest. God, thank you for that relationship. We love you. And it's in your son's name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing together. 'Cause I wait for you.
See you next Sunday. We love you. Jesus is better.
been singing since I laid my burden down. Glory, glory, I've been singing since I laid my burden down. I'm singing hallelujah. Since I laid my burden down, yeah, I feel better, so much better. Since I laid, oh Lord, I laid my burden down, I'm singing.